I guess we're ready, everybody. Try this again. Before we get started here, I've got a commercial for the 50th anniversary July 4th flood, 1969, from the Archival Society for $5. I don't know, Margaret had some. I don't know if she's got more. Yeah, Margaret's got a whole handful back there, so be sure to get one or two or three. Tonight, I welcome you to the Stories of Vermilion Oral History Series, presented by the Vermilion Area Archival Society in collaboration with the Vermilion History Museum and the Ritter Public Library. My name is Rich Tarrant, the curator of the Vermilion History Museum. The program is going to be videotaped, so please turn off your cell phones. Our guests tonight are Janet Wagner and Karen Boss, longtime residents of Vermilion's Linwood Park. I want to mention one thing here about Karen's book, Through These Gates. I keep Karen's book underneath my keyboard right by my computer all the time because I use it. It's a good reference book.
Excellent.
It's
Thank
really
you.
A great one. If you don't have it, try to find a book. And with that, here's Janet and Karen.
Karen and I are both, our grandchildren are both seventh generation to go to Linwood Park. And so in 1884, our great-grandfathers were there at the beginning, and now our grandchildren are actually, our children and our grandchildren are actually friends, so it's kind of neat. I go back just a little bit further. My great-grandfather was a circuit rider, and he was the first minister at the E&R Church, which was then the German Evangelicals, and he preached in German in 1879. And he was here for a year, and it was his first assignment, and he went out to five different churches as far as Norwalk on a horse and preached at five different churches. So I love Linwood, and I think you're going to understand how much we do by these pictures. Karen is the author of Through These Gates, and she did the history of the whole area, and it's fascinating. The library does have copies of these books, and I'm not an author. I was an instigator, and my daughter actually did the writing compiling for, it's called The Linwood Trees, which is the families about Linwood. But anyway, we want to tell you about Linwood, and Karen's going to do the history part. And I might bump her and add something, but she's the one that really knows the history. And then I'll tell a little bit about what's going on more currently there. So go ahead, Karen.
Okay. Well, excuse my voice problems here. This first picture, this is a very early picture, and that's a sleigh there, right?
Yes.
It's not a horse and buggy. It may look like it. And obviously, this is this was 09, right? Because it was the 125th anniversary. But that's basically the same scene. That, okay.
Slide.
Okay, Jacob Albright lived in Pennsylvania, and he formed a new religion. He wanted to be part of the Methodists, and the Methodists didn't want him because they were all German immigrants, and the Methodists said they didn't have the funds to cater to them. And ironically, it wasn't until...
It was in 1850, they wanted to join the Methodist Church, and the Methodist Church wanted them also to preach in English, and they preached only in German. My great-grandfather preached only in German until 1893, and then he started to preach in both. So it was in 1965, I believe, roughly, give or take a year, that they joined the Methodist Church, and it's called the United Methodist. It evolved into the Evangelical United Brethren. So this is how Linwood started.
So Jacob Albright was the founder of it. It's called the...
The German Evangelical?
Evangelical Association, except the German translation of it. The other side is a circuit reader, like Janet said, that her great-grandfather was. And when Ohio was first opened up, that's what a lot of the ministers did. They rode from one station to the next station so they could preach to all the different areas that needed being preached to.
Slide. Okay, your mic is, are you hearing, Karen? Okay,
good. This is an engraving of an early camp meeting. Camp meetings were held usually in August every summer. And people sort of were rewarding themselves for having gotten through the summer planning and, I can't think of the words, I'm sorry.
Well, it was like a big revival, if you hear about them, and they also were teaching the teachers how to teach Sunday school, because most of the churches didn't even have buildings. They were meeting in little houses, and they were called Sunday school groups. So they first met, was it in Birmingham, at a farm?
They moved around a lot. Okay. It was several different places.
Okay. Slide.
Okay, now this is a combination of scenes, I think. Other than the top one, those are pretty much modern scenes. My book, the first edition of my book came out in 1984. And you gotta help me here.
Okay. She told about the history of the area. This was the Firelands area. In her book, she also tells about the history of the denomination. And the denomination there, they went from Rochester, Pennsylvania to Toledo. This was a big open area. You know, back at the beginning, there were only four counties in Ohio. Now there's 88 as the population grew. So they had a big, long district. So a lot of our people come from Pennsylvania still that come to.
Okay. One interesting thing, if I can get this out, is it was along the lakefront. We were still getting fresh German immigrants, so they were still preaching in German. Whereas you go further down towards Columbus, they were speaking English. So that was one conference with the Ohio Conference. Up along, that's why the area that comprised our conference, called the Erie Conference, went from about Sandusky over to Pittsburgh. So it's funny, even when we had a payphones in the park, that they had Pittsburgh telephone.
Pittsburgh book. Telephone phone books, okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Slide.
You can explain.
Okay, well, the Linwood Park was in the middle was a, called Wagner's Woods, and it was a shooting gallery and maybe a beer hall and all kinds of things, and people would come there to picnic. And on either side of the park, and I learned this from Karen recently, there, where the cottages are now, those were fields, and those were farmed and rented out. And the property was bought from Nicholas Wagner, and then he moved and he started the Wagner Hotel, which is where the photo journal is now. That building is still there, and it was recently restored, and you saw Wagner's Hotel on the side of it when they were doing it. So that's where that comes from. Okay. Slide. We'll just let you read some of this because it's hard to read it sideways. There were 250 shares of stock, and it was formed as a company, not just, and they were in business to make it work.
I don't think there was any such thing as a nonprofit.
No, it was not nonprofit, never nonprofit. Okay, slide.
Bishop Horn was bishop of the entire denomination when Linwood was started, and they gave him his choice of whichever lot he wanted, and he chose the one. It was on the west side, but it was the first one on the lake of the west side, and it was unfortunately torn down a couple of years ago. So this was a year before it was torn down.
Yes, yes, yes. And, okay, slide. Okay. The tabernacle was first constructed in 1884 along with 12 cottages, and we showed you the gatehouse, which Matt lives in now. That was constructed then, too. And we do, it's a business. You rented the lots, you got a 99-year lease, and the lots went from about $35 to $75 per lot then, which was a lot of money back then. And we still do not own our property. We own our cottages. Slide. And this is a picture of the gatehouse to begin with and then how it looks pretty much now. Slide.
This was one of our... this was one of our earliest superintendents, and our superintendents live up at the gatehouse, and they sort of, at the direction of the board, manage the park. They hire the people to work in it, and they supervise them. And Mr. Heininger was one of the earliest, and Matt Crakes is our current one. So I asked Matt to reproduce this picture when we came out with. Oh, I did want to mention too that my original book was published in 1984, and my plan always was to hopefully, we ran up the second year, and there were no books available for 25 years. So I always hoped that I might be able to update it when the time came for the 125th. So, fortunately, I was able to. And Janet also wrote a book. Our books are very different.
I compiled, she wrote. Slide. Okay, there were two tabernacles, one on each side of the park, and the one was German, and the other was English. And if the the English tabernacle was not very popular, and so if they didn't have services there for, I think it was about 5 years, then they had to give it back to the park, and the park put the benches around and used them and sold other things and then tore it down. Slide. And this is a picture of the first, the tabernacle, and the sides are still there. The benches we still use, and it had a flat roof and straw on the floor, and that's a sign that it says, glory to the God in highest. And Karen had me redraw that and put it back up for the 100th anniversary.
I got the minutes of the Linwood Park Company from the very beginning, the first 30 years, I think, were an old German script. And I had a heck of a time getting somebody to translate that, because during World War II, they stopped using it completely. But I lived in New Jersey at the time, and it was, I had a friend who was from Germany. She put me in touch with an elderly church janitor in Philadelphia, and he read it into a tape recorder for me straight off the written page. It was incredible. He charged me $1 a page, and at the time, the going rate was $18 a page, so they got a good deal. Still cost a lot of money, though. So that's where I was able to get the old German script, and then I gave it to Janet, and she reproduced it, and it's hanging in the back of the tabernacle now.
Slide.
This thing,
this is... I think this is, I'm not sure what they put the top on, which has an official name.
It's called a monitor.
A monitor.
And it was very, very dark. inside there. So they raised the middle section to let light into the tabernacle. And then it wasn't until much later after that that they...
Then they put sides on later on.
Yeah,
right.
Yeah, it wasn't until like the 40s, I think.
Yes, yes. And the windows were just redone this past year. So, slide.
That's the English tabernacle on the left.
And then when they sold the benches, that's my great-grandfather sitting on one of the benches. They used them around the park. Germans did not waste anything. Slide.
This is our original bell tower. And the bell was given to the park by a company that made bells for individual congregations. And this was like the floor sample that they gave them to the church camp meeting grounds with the hope that people from all the churches would buy them, that use that as a floor model. So now the bell tower has been rebuilt and it's horizontal, mm-hmm. I believe. But the original one, same location, everything, but the original was vertical siding. So they don't open it when
he opens it on Sunday to let the sound out. It still gets rung every Sunday morning, and every time there's a wedding, Joel comes and rings the bell for us. Slide. Okay, well, they were in business, and this is a list of some of the things that they did. Everybody got charged. If you brought people to the park in your wagon, you had to get their permission and you had to pay a fee. So they were in business, and to keep the park running, everybody had to pay and everybody paid to come in. Slide, and we're going to show you some pictures of some of these. Okay.
I think two things interesting about this picture. This was the milk depot, it's called, but just a highwheel bicycle show.
Yeah, there's a bicycle. Can you see the wheel, the bicycle?
Oh, the high wheel. See,
and then them. And then a guy, it looks like he's sitting there with a rifle too. So we think that this picture came from when it was still Wagner's Woods, what
no,
it was called.
They
used it then too, right?
They had the games and everything lasted quite a while.
Oh, okay.
Into after the church. It was sort of a cross between an amusement park and a church camp meeting.
Okay, slide.
This was the boarding house, which is right when you're coming past the tabernacle towards the beach. It predated the hotel, which was a couple years later.
And people say, oh, I heard the hotel burned down. It did not burn down, but this was one of the structures that did burn down. Okay, slide.
This is the ice house, and they cut the ice out of the lake during the winter and put it in this building, and it had padded it with straw to keep it cold until the summer when they would deliver it to people and sell it.
Slide.
This was the original stand, and it was Janet, something I never thought of before. The reason our stand. You can tell.
Okay. Well, we've kind of figured out, or I guess, they called it the stand, and there's also another thing that you went and you stood, and it was called the stand. You stood and wrote out your postcards. So the stand in the middle of the park is an ice cream parlor and everything now, but it's called the stand, and people always say, why is it called the stand? Well, I think they just transferred the name when they tore these buildings down and put the new one up and called it the stand because that was called the stand. Okay, slide.
Now this, I believe, was a bookstore. They had so many different leases that they leased out to people. And so one of the concessionaires was operating a bookstore there. This was on the right, was the dining hall. And when Nicholas Wagner had it, it was a beer hall and dance hall. And so once the church took it over, of course, there was no more beer coming out of that building. It became a dining hall. And people didn't have kitchens in the beginning. But after a very short time, they started adding kitchens on the backs of the cottages. And how I deduced that was that all the cottages went up in value. A very small amount, you know, but in a couple of years, everybody had a kitchen. So. Okay.
Slide.
This is the bathhouse, and even though all of the, I can't think of the name of it, it's been a long time, the person who ran the bathhouse and the carousel and
okay.
Hattie,
well, I don't know her name, but Hattie somebody.
Yeah, but I believe he sent them away to Germany because they had way greater.
The pictures, you mean?
Yes. Yeah,
okay, they took the pictures and they were usually on glass slides and they sent them to Germany and they colored the pictures. They were black and white, of course. And that's why some of these old slides you'll see, they were colored and then produced and then printed in Germany.
But he would write on the back of each one what color to make things, or he would write, put a moon in, or whatever directions he wanted them to do. So most of the ones you see in the bathhouse do have the red roof. So, and in fact, when they took this down, they used the lumber to build the shuffleboard courts and the picnic shelters. And so Janet said, until recently.
Yeah, until Matt painted them all last year and they got sited and everything, for those of you that are from Linwood and got the new electric and everything. On one of them, you could look up and you could see 10 cents. That's how much you could rent a wool bathing suit for. And they had baskets you put them in, but first you had to run it through the ringer so someone else could rent it for another 10 cents. Okay, slide.
This is Cloudy. His name was Louis Noel. He was French-Canadian. I think everybody that has lived in Vermilion any time at all is probably familiar with Cloudy. He ran a ferry service from the swamp over to across the river. And there was a gate on the far east side of the park. And you went down a path, and he had this boat, and he would take you across. So this was his first boat, and then later he had a second boat.
And just a couple years ago, we all look for beach glass and things, and they found a coin that was from Cloudy, and you paid 10 cents, and that was to go one way, and then you came back for free or whatever it was, but they found a coin, so we have that in our museum. It just, you know, got uncovered recently. So slide. This is just another
picture.
That's
the other. That's the second boat there.
Okay. Slide. And then this is the catwalk that you could walk across to get across the swamp, which is the lagoons now. Okay. Slide. Okay.
They call it a hack, and they went from the train station in town and brought people into the park every time a train came in. So that was,
And that was one of the concessions. They had to pay a fee to the park, and they bid on it, and they always went to the highest bidder if it was 50 cents more. Whatever they paid, maybe it was $50 or something, for the right to bring people into Linwood Park. They were making money to run the park. Slide. These are some of the pictures. We're going to show you several of the old hotel. And this would have been one of the colored, pictures that they had colored.
Tinted.
Tinted, okay. Slide. another view of it. That's from the 40s, I believe. Slide. Slide.
This is when, 1965?
Yes.
The hotel was being dismantled. And did you just tell me the other day that you know who?
No, I was just a couple years ago, we were walking around town inviting people to come into Linwood, all the shop owners, and saying, you know, you can come in for free and bring your employees in. And we went in the barbershop, which is no longer a barbershop, and there was a man sitting there, and he said, oh, I've been to Linwood. I helped tear down the old hotel, and he was a teenager, with his uncle or something like that, and his uncle used the lumber to build a house on Baumhart Road. And I wasn't quick enough to say, what's the address? But they still didn't waste anything.
And ironically, at the exact same time, this was being torn down, the Crystal Beach Ballroom.
Torn down the same year, yeah. And they sold everything out of it, but it became obsolete because the highway was built, people wanted more. There was a bathroom on each floor, and then there was another room that you could sign up to take a bath. And, you know, they wanted more to life. And my mom used to say, well, we just took a bar of soap and went down and washed in the lake.
A lot of people said that.
And, yeah, people lived differently than what we want now, but people wanted more, and it had been, you know, deteriorating everything, plus the people that were running it were retiring.
Hannah Morey was the cook,
yes.
And she and Myrtle Hedges ran it together, but Hannah was retiring. She was the cook for the school district, I think it was.
Yes, she ran the cafeteria here at school.
And she was getting ready to retire, and she didn't want to do the Linwood Hotel anymore, and so that was a big part of the reason. They didn't have anyone else lined up to do the cooking, and it was very well known for Anna's cooking.
Okay, slide. Part of it was built in 1887.
No. Yeah, it was a couple of years later.
And then the
western end, and then wanted to add an addition, they had to pick it up and turn it around, and then they added the long part to it.
And there were other rooming houses there, and this was one of them that I would assume that one came down in the 1910 fire too.
Yes, that would have.
Okay, slide. This is showing in 1910. April 1st was the fire of all fires. 22 cottages burnt, and this was my great-grandfather's cottage. They had moved it just a couple years earlier from one part of the park, and they dismantled it. It was a big Victorian, they took off the turret or the porches and everything, and they used logs, and they rolled it up on logs and put it on the corner where it is now. And then it was just there a few years, and they put different porches on, kind of modernized it with a look then. And so these are pictures my great-grandfather took. And what he called the Holocaust, he called it.
Oh, really?
Yeah. But those are there's a cottage rebuilt in its place with what they got from the insurance, which was, I've heard $500 and I've heard $900, but they had to have a cottage up and ready to go by season. And so after April 1st, when they cleared it away, they put a new cottage up. But other cottages around it are older because, are newer rather. Okay? Slide. Okay. We'll just let you read things as opposed to reading everything for you. Okay. People just wanted more. They did not, you know, want the same type of things we were getting spoiled. Okay, slide. This is, again, the picture of the tabernacle. It's the same one, but a little bit bigger.
And those were canvas sides that they rolled up. And that was before the monitor was put on.
And according to some of the old stories, the sermons or what the programs would go on sometimes for 3 hours. It was hot and it was uncomfortable. Okay, slide. This is what it looks like today. Nicely painted and also sided, but we made the siding in the same direction and everything, so that, and we've just redone all the windows. Okay, slide. It used to get packed. This was in 1943. They had their summer assembly, they called it, where the denomination would come from all over. But it wasn't just the German evangelicals, the EUBs. They rented it out to other groups too. So they had their week there, and every cottage was required to, if you had an extra room, you had to rent it out. So if you go in a lot of the cottages now, the numbers are still on the doors. And you rented them out, and young gentlemen early on were allowed to sleep on the pews if they had no place else to sleep. Okay, slide. And this, they had meetings outside too.
This would be on the bank of the lake, and I'm pretty sure that's right at the top of the Tabernacle Street steps where they used to have.
Okay, slide. This is what it looks like today. A little brighter inside and friendly. And every Sunday you're welcome to come in the park if you want to come and at the services. And then we do have some special events that it's open to the public to come in without paying the gate fee.
Or if you want to buy an ice cream cone.
Yes, if you want to buy, yes. We'll get to that, yeah. But we have a nice sound system, and it's light and bright, and we also have cushions on all the chairs.
I'd like to point out one thing. On either side, you can see on the left side, we made these quilts for the centennial, and it wasn't just Linwood people. That, I think the Schwensen family, Arliss, made one, and think her name, the Crystal Beach family made one, and so we have quite a few. If you ever get in the Tabernacle, be sure and look at the, you know.
Yeah, we'll have a couple pictures of those close up later on. Okay, slide. Lots and lots of weddings go on, lots and lots of baptisms. So this is an older one in the chapel. And in 2001, that's my daughter and son-in-law getting married, but there were 12 weddings that summer. And we usually have several a year. They try to have them on the beach if the weather's good too, so. And people from town, you know, rent cottages. In fact, I know of 3 cottages that are rented this fall for 2 different weekends because people are coming back to as a location to have their weddings here. And so they rent those or rent the upper rooms. Okay. Okay, this is an old picture that George Wakefield drew for Karen's book.
On the left, he drew the one freehand on the left-hand side. And then Janet superimposed. Go ahead.
I just found in one of the cottages there's a picture, and we took it with my husband's phone, of the original map. And if I can show you on here, this is, that's Linwood up there, but it used to come all the way, I'm fine, I'm right here. It used to come all the way down, across the railroad tracks, and Okay, this is Linwood Park now, and that part is still there that has the, Burger King, and that comes that way. But it used to come all the way down here, so it's part of Romps, and also going into Beulah. So it was all that, but this was when, and this was interesting that the swamp, which he has showing here, the marsh, was owned by this family and that family, and then another family owned that middle part, and then down here, different ones owned the property when it was all a swamp, which I thought was interesting. Okay, slide. This is a map of today and the cottages that each one represents a cottage or a building. But if all the lots were filled up, I counted, and all the usable lots, there would have been 555 cottages. Most of the lots are 30 by 50. And they had planned it, and obviously they didn't all get sold, thank goodness. And a lot of us own more than one lot so that we have a place to park the cars and everything. So, okay, slide. This is just showing some of the old streets were just grass, and then gravel was put on them. And
we had wooden, wooden sidewalks
we'll show that.
Originally. And I believe they were taken up in the winter and put back down in the summer. And that's the English Tabernacle.
And that's the English Tabernacle, and then these are some of the cottages that burned. And this actual area is all still open. There's just parking in there. Okay, slide. And this is on the lakefront, just to show you some of the cottages. Okay, slide. Okay, here's
the sidewalk.
They're wooden sidewalks. And that's what the roads look like. So you bumped over them. Okay. All right.
And you can tell from looking, almost every cottage in the beginning had a second story airing porch that they could string, you know, ropes up to hang up their bathing suits to dry or whatever.
Okay, slide. And this is what it looks today. We are self-sufficient, and we have to pay for our own roads and our own sidewalks. And it was quite a project, and we have now a good foundation, which there never was, and we don't have bumpy roads anymore, and they are used. We actually have two colors of sidewalks, is what I say, because everybody is on both. You know, we don't just walk on a sidewalk. The kids are going up and down with their bicycles and playing games, and it's just become even more friendly because of the new roads and sidewalks. Okay, slide. We have lots of entertainment for you, and for anybody that comes, we don't have the shooting gallery anymore, but behind it shows a shuffleboard, and then you can kind of see part of the basketball court, and this is our new concrete tennis table. And they say it bounces on it, and the kids love it. It's really getting used a lot. So that replaced the old horseshoes that they used to pitch. Those have been gone for a few years, and that replaced those. Okay, slide. This is just an old picture of the tennis courts. How many were there? Like four or six, and they were clay courts to begin with. Okay, slide. And that's just a picture of some of the old playground. We still have, those slides are still there. There's an old picture of them. They were on the beach at one time. Our beach was much bigger, and there were trees growing on the beach. And if you can imagine, these metal slides
got
sliding
very
down, they were very hot.
In and the were, 50s when we yeah. were little. Bit.
But they moved them up soon into the actual grove part. But the teeter-totters, of course, or whatever you want to call those, seesaws, we've replaced the boards over and over, but it's the same frames that are there.
Many and the merry-go-round.
It's
those
a different
merry-go-round,
yes.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay, slide. This is part of our new park. And every year, I think it's the third graders, correct me if I'm wrong, they come and have their end-of-the-year picnic in the park. The fourth graders? Okay. Okay, Sally Fox, who's a retired teacher from Vermilion and has lived in the park forever and raised her kids there, she started that. So we still invite them in, and they come and have a lot of fun. Okay, slide. Here's some of the old wool bathing suits. And this picture, and I have some others over there on a board. Vermilion and Linwood have always been very much meshed together as far as the people that have worked there in the summertime and also the people that have lived there that, you know, contribute to Vermilion. And this is a picture of, I got the whole old album of the Millers. If you go down to Miller's Farm, they've been in the park since the very beginning. They have a cottage there too. But this was from his grandmother's. And she had her album that she took pictures and then she wrote on it. So it was really cute. Okay, slide. This is another view of the bathhouse.
This is the bathhouse from the far end. Trying to think what that building.
I don't know what that is, yeah. Okay, slide. This is the beach on a better day. Again, the water is very high. In 85, the water levels were very high, and in 2.5 weeks, we lost 4.5 acres of beach, and it's back up again. All the Great Lakes are very high, so it'll come back, hopefully. Okay, slide. There's another old picture. You can see some of the trees that were right on the beach and how big the beach was. Slide. And this is in the 60s. Okay, slide. And they used to clean the beach the hard way.
Now, we had a long series of horses, and they were all named Dolly, except one. One was named Charlie. But I don't know why, but we used to go up and feed them. And they were up at the gate, and it was a half door. So the horse would put his head out, and kids would go up and feed him apples. And he, the same wagon, this was the same wagon would take, pick up the garbage, and it would take around kerosene for the stoves, were kerosene stoves, and ice. You know, those wagons got a lot of use. And it cleaned up the beach with that wagon.
Okay, slide. There's a couple of the different dollies. Okay, slide. Okay, this was the flood. These are some pictures I took. And our beach has been used for many things. We've had planes land on it. We've had boats washed up on it. Our bell tower's been used to call people to, you know, for emergencies to come. And this was when the big flood was, and you'll be seeing a lot about that next year. Okay.
And one of the things the bell tower, I mean, yeah, the bells were used for was the end of World War II. And it was in August, I think, and everyone came pouring out of their cottages. And some people went to the tabernacle to pray, and some people went to the hotel to party. So depending on your pen, I guess.
The car there, several of them came through the fence between the lagoons and Linwood, and then the electric lines had come down, so it was sparking, and it was really scary. And that's a helicopter because they rescued people off the roofs of the lagoons. And other times during when we've had the river flood and backup and everything and the lagoons has flooded, they've brought all their cars up in the wintertime and stuff and stayed where they were safe up in Linwood. Okay, slide. Just a couple more pictures. Okay, slide. And the water level's very high again. And we have a lot of erosion. Every place does. Okay, slide. And that was in 85. And can you see the taproot here? It ate away the bank. And then we put, they were called Campbell's modules, and we put them in. And you'll be able to see that they're underwater. They were put in. The idea was to break the waves so take the power out of the waves so they could take less of the bank away. And slide, you can see, they worked. And the beach started to build up behind them. And they're 6 feet tall, so you're just seeing part of them. Okay, slide. And there they are. You can see the top of them, and the beach is building up behind them. And then I think this is probably when they were moved out, additional 25 feet. Okay, slide. And this is the water level's high again. And can you see them here? It's eaten away in the bank. This is close up of the bank, but it's eaten away. Okay, slide. This is our grocery store, which was built in 1905 and was used. And the people, the vendors around here used to come, and Swenson's would deliver fresh bakery every day to the hotel and also to the store. And there was a lean-to on the back where the butcher would come and actually butcher the meat. And the farmers would come with the produce. And now we use it as it's a museum on the side, and then we have crafters that have their things in there for sale. And slide. That's the inside last year. Opening day, we took that. And okay, slide. And these are some of the memorabilia around. And over here, when you wanted ice, how much you wanted, you hung the sign in the window, and that told them how much to deliver, because they didn't always have that ice house. Later, they would buy the ice from town that was cut out of the river. And those are our tongs there that you would do the ice, and there's old milk cans up there, and this is I think it's called a scythe that they cut the grass with. But it's kind of, there's all kinds of neat. This is a picture which we scounded from your website of them cutting the, so we could explain how they did that. Okay, slide. And this is, that's just Swenson's Bakery would deliver. Okay, slide. This is our store. It's called the Stand, and above it are the upper rooms, and there's 8 rooms up there of various sizes, and we rehabbed that 7 years ago. It hadn't been used since the hotel was torn down because it was a dormitory for the girls that worked in the hotel. Some of the boys would sleep in the attic of the hotel, but the girls slept there. It was a cold water flat, and now it's hot and cold, but we've kept all the rooms the same, but they're all nicely furnished and no air conditioning, though. But you can rent those by night. If you're going to rent a cottage, you rent it by the week. But you can rent those and just come for a night. So they've been just phenomenal for the park to have overflow if you have extra people coming and can't stay in your cottage, or if you just want to come for a few nights. We've had several people rent the whole thing when they have weddings in town, and they'd have their people stay there. And we've also, rented out to different groups. Okay.
Some cottage owners will rent a weekend in the fall, but on the whole, it's just
and
a week at a time.
Well, I've had people that were working on their boats, so they'd come and stay there because they, were in the process of working on the boat. And down below then is the Stand, which is an ice cream parlor, and we have light lunches, and if you can give the slide, I'll show the inside of that. And that's been totally refurbished. And you're welcome to come to the park. You can stay for an hour and a half and come in and get some ice cream or get lunch and visit the store when it's open. Okay, slide. And other groups always came. This was Rockefeller came with his Sunday school.
I started to talk before.
Go ahead. Sorry.
Pete Wall was the name of the man who ran the Stand for many years. He had 3 daughters, and when I first started working on my original book, Hattie, who was one of the 3 daughters, was 97 years old. And so I looked her up somewhere the other side of Cleveland, and she told me that she, at the end of every picnic day, she would walk around selling balloons on a stick tied to the end of the stick. And her father would tell her to go out until she sold every last balloon, you know. So anyway, John D. Rockefeller, of course, was from Cleveland. And every year he would bring his Sunday school class out to the park. And she had one balloon left. And she wanted to sell it so bad. And he wouldn't buy it. And 97 years old, and she was still mad about it. She said, if he had that much money, he could afford a nickel balloon or whatever it was.
Okay, Sly. And we have a parade every year, and we have our famous Linwood Marching Band, which does
Except
not march.
They don't march.
And anybody's welcome to be in it, and they practice about a half an hour ahead of time. And as you can see, if you have red, white, and blue, you wear it that day, and we open it to the whole community. And a lot of our cars and everything that are in the parade come in, and it's just fun. Ken can tell you all about that another time. That's a program in itself. Okay, slide.
And this was from the main program at the end of the centennial. We did that centennial very good. Everybody that was in the park did something to contribute to it. Schwentz had made this cake for us. It was six pan, you know, cakes put together, each one with a different scene of old Linwood's history, you know, and they just really knocked themselves out. They did a wonderful job. And so we always called our senior citizens the Linwood Pioneers. And so we had our Linwood Pioneers cut the cake for us. So that's what is going on there.
Okay, slide. Those are the quilts. So come and see them, and for the 125th, we did another quilt too, but they're really neat. Okay, slide. And you can read that real quick. There's three parts to it, as the Linwood Park Company runs it as a company. And then we have our Council of Christian Life. And we are not affiliated with any church. We say we're interdenominational. Everybody's welcome. And then we have the cottage owners, which work, do a lot of the programs and the fun things around the park, and work with the park company to add things like things to the playground, or we run the store and museum and things like that. Slide. And this is what the park company does, and we couldn't do it without them. And slide. And this is also the Linwood Lodge, and that has 13 rooms. And that you book years in advance, you get on the list. We had one family, or one Sunday school group from a Lutheran church in Pittsburgh that rented it for 75 years straight. their 1 week. It used to be, there used to be camps, and kids would, you know, go to camp, and when that stopped. So, but it's been used and rented, you know, off season too by other groups. Okay, slide. Just some of the things we do, the social side of it. Okay, slide. And that Christian life. Slide. And that's it. So we're open to questions.
Okay.
When is the hours for your church service? And I take it you don't have a German service anymore.
No.
No.
You showed a picture about 1943 of the tabernacle, and it looked like it was a concert or something, but you referenced that it was, again, Germans.
Well, not by then, it wasn't. I mean,
it was
German heritage.
I can tell you when the German, when they stopped World War I. Yes, there was a lot. And they took down most of the German, probably most of the cottages had German names. And they were, I won't say forced into it, but made to feel very uncomfortable if they had German names. And somebody just, I think during the 125th anniversary, somebody said they found up in their attic of their cottage a German name. Did you hear about this?
No, huh?
Yeah, I forget which one it was. And it's sort of heartwarming that in the last several years, there's been a couple new German names that have it there.
Yes, they put them back up,
That they're putting up. So we were glad to see that.
But yeah, we're all kind of proud of our German heritage, but you know, back then, and as it is now, we're Americans, so, you know. Yeah, and they made sure that they raised a big flag and everything, to the American flag, to let the people of Vermilion know. A lot of people in Vermilion were German heritage, too, so this whole area was, you know, developed by German heritage people. And what was the other question? Oh, the church service is at 10:45. And anybody's welcome to come in, and you just tell them at the gate that you're coming in for the service. And also, you know, you can come for other events. If you want to come and look around, just say, I'm coming to check it out. I'd like to go in the stand and stuff. And you can come in for an hour and a half. There's always been a gate fee going through my great-grandfather's information stuff. One year they printed 15,000 tickets. They were 10 cents each, but can you imagine 15,000 tickets? But people came, and other churches used it, and other groups used it. Lorraine, a whole bunch of them. They had the Lorraine school church picnic there, and so all the churches came, and they, you know, drive over or ride the train out. So, and the third question, or was there? Did we get them all? Okay. Anybody else? Yes, sir.
There are a lot of mailboxes near the entrance.
Yes.
How was mail delivered before the mailboxes were installed?
Okay. In the stand, there used to be, they had taken it out of the hotel, but there's a box, and now it's in the museum, and they put, it had numbers on it for the rooms or something, but anyway, we put letters on it, and you used to have to go in, and it was all delivered there, and then you would look under W, I'm a wagoner, look under W and pull out my mail. So, but those are for the people that live there year-round, and also the people that, there's some people that spend most of the summer there, so they'll have their mail forwarded. Yes. Yes, Ted.
I know the answer to this question, but I think it's interesting.
Well, then tell us the answer, too.
The horse and wagon and Dolly collected the rubbish once a week. Where did he take it, the horse and wagon, to dump the rubbish?
I don't know. Do you tell us? Where did you know where he took it?
Yes.
Where?
The big green spot that is now a big lawn where Rob's is.
Yes.
The big green piece of grass.
Oh, okay.
That was a rubbish dump.
Okay. Well, we own part of that at that point. Okay.
That's why there's never anybody built there, because that was a rubbish dump. And then when Rob built his,
yeah.
The dirt that he dug out to build the boat slips, they covered the rubbish over with the dirt. That's why you have that big piece of green grass there.
Awesome. Thank you for that information.
There will never be anything but green grass, because that's what they dump. And I would say this, you talk about recycling. You said they came and picked up the garbage. No, that's incorrect. They only took the rubbish. The food garbage, I was a kid, was in a small can, and the guy from the pig farm came and took it.
To feed the pigs.
Okay.
Garbage in there. It was only just rubbish. They recycled the garbage. It went to the farm for the animals.
Awesome. Yes.
Is the book available?
Okay.
Does it cost?
you can get the book. We are not selling anything here. You can get the books. You can check them out at the library. They have them upstairs. But we also have them for sale in our museum shop.
Do you know the cost?
Yours is what?
$36.
$36. And mine is $49.
And I might add, that's a huge loss.
Yeah.
Writing books is not a profit-making.
No. Labor's a love, and Karen, when she did this for the 100th anniversary, she took all the information and she went up to the, well, from lots of people, but she also went up and researched each cottage, and she did this with her mother on cards and had one for each cottage. I did the same research, and I went up and I wrote everything down, and I don't know how many days I drove up and wrote everything down, and then I put in a typewriter and zoop, popped up for, you know, I could pop it up under each address. And I would check with her if I didn't have it, and ours matched 100%. Yeah. But she did it all by hand. So.
Well, it was still the same research, so.
Yeah, but it was, yeah.
How we did it. But we were very gratified that we came up with the same answer, so we figured it had to be right.
Yeah. So. Or we were both wrong.
Yeah, that could have been too.
For the past 40 years, roughly 15. I've retired there, been there 7 years. If you look at the changeover of some of these cottages, we last about 25 years. We die off and somebody else lives in our cottage, that type of thing. But we've retired there. Those of us that have retired, we love it so much. You know, if we only wanted to have one home, we've retired to Linwood.
It pretty much. Yeah, most of the people are retirees.
Yeah, I rented my cottage for 28 years, and then we retired to it. We made it into a year-round home because they were very, you know, rustic, and we put on a foundation. It's a major job to do that, yes. Right across from where my cottage is now, okay, on Walnut Street. We went from Walnut to Linwood. Linden, yeah. So you would have just, your cottage might have been where part of it was. Yeah. Yes, it went between the two streets. It took the whole, it took up quite a few lots. I think 6 lots or something, yeah. At least, yeah.
When I was tracing every owner of every cottage, I did it for the date plaques.
Yes.
And that was my whole reason behind it. Janet did it to put it in her book, right? So we had two different purposes, but did the same thing.
Yeah. Karen told about the history. My book was to pick up where she left off and put personal stories in it. So they're totally different. I didn't need to repeat what she had already done because she did such a great job. Okay. So we wind it up. Thank you for coming.